All right, how you getting on? You well? How are you bloody doing? Come on! This is a party or what?
I'm dead on that. And blink your eyes on me. I said you're holding on. He said, shut up and dance with me.
How are you doing? You good? Back in the shed, guys. Back in the shed. You've heard of back of the net? You've heard of Elf on a Shelf? Well, this... Actually, I've never heard of Elf on a Shelf. This meme is not for me. I don't know what you're talking about. I have to now Google what it is. Might do Elf on a Shelf, but I don't... We've been very good for not parenting with this abstract eye in the sky watching everything my son does, you know? I like the idea of the Elf on the Shelf being like, what's he going to do? Where's he going to go now? What's he going to do? Where's he? He's in the fruit bowl! Sonny! He's in the fruit bowl! You know? He's in the fridge! What's he doing in the fridge? What's he doing in the fridge? You know? That's all fun. But this idea that he's watching, and he's watching at all times, that's not going to fly. I tell you, it's tough. You know? It's tough, but it didn't really work on us, you know? Holy God is watching. Baby Jesus saw you do that, and Baby Jesus is making you cry now. Because that, you know? Remember one time my ma was smoking and a bit of cigarette fell over. Or no, I was dancing around her bed while she was getting ready. This is back in the 90s, you know. So, I mean, she's got the most flammable CFC gas hairspray in her hair. You know, a fag in the mouth, you know. And I'm jumping up and down before she was heading out. And, you know, I jumped by her my arm caught the side of her smoke, and I was like, ow! And she goes, now, holy God did that now, because you're annoying me. Holy God did that. Because you're trying to spend quality time with me now before I leave. To find a new daddy. No. But she did do that, so... But, like, she's a great man. Great man. You know, would do anything for us, and has done everything, you know? She's like one of those fish that, like, give their organs to... Isn't there, like, a fish that does that? Isn't there, like, a fish that the small fish, like, hangs onto and then that fish eventually dies and withers away? That's kind of what my mom does for us, you know? So it's not bad me saying that, me highlighting that she did that one. Anyway, look, we've been very good for having no abstract eyes in the sky, so I'll have to figure out another way of doing this Elf on a Shelf business. How are you doing? You got all your bits for Christmas? I don't know what you're talking about. I got my fucking NCT done there. Thank God for that. Speaking of Christmas, it feels like, you know the way Stephen's Day, or Boxing Day, if you're a prick. I don't know. No, it feels like the opposite of, you know, sometimes on Boxing Day or Stephen's Day, you might feel a bit sad, being like, oh, tell you now, it's 364 days away for Christmas. Ah, it's the longest time away from Christmas again. It's a bit sad, a little bit, you know. Or for me, the 23rd of October, the day after my birthday, when I have to wait another fucking year for my birthday, you know. That's kind of the opposite vibe. Today is like the anti-Stephen's Day. I'm not saying that you've got a transitioned auntie/uncle, auntie to Stephen. But I mean, it's the, you know, like the anti, anyway, it's like the anti-Stephen's Day, where it's the greatest day because I don't have to wait another 364 days to, actually, weirdly, it's like the 24th of November, 24, ages away for this next NCT. Last time I went in there, I don't know why, but it was under 6 months away. I had to get it done. So anyway, look, you don't, I'm not, and also you should be out on the streets wearing sailor outfits, kissing broads in black and white photos. This is V-Day for you, because I don't have to bring up the fucking NCT for another year. So you should be absolutely... Look, everyone's delighted to see the back of them. And I said to... I brought my son there to the NCT, and I was like, here, Sonny, you know your best pal Woody from Toy Story? You know your pal Woody? Well, do you want to see a place where there's loads of Woodies? Bunch of fucking cowboys. Do you want to see where there's a bunch of fucking Woodies, a bunch of cowboys? Well, then come with me to the NCD Centre. I didn't say that. I said, Sonny, there's going to be a man. And I think I can say that. I would say, I say, well, you know, likelihood it'll be a man. Doesn't have to be a man, but likelihood will there be a man, and he'll be put our car up on a lift, and he'll be looking at it. And he was like, well, someone's lifting up the fucking car. Absolutely, I'm there. So we went there first thing this morning, had a donut. Not much facilities for kids, I have to say. NCT Dean's Grange, 1 star, says Tony. And the review reads, not one little, abacus for a child. There was no abacus for a child to play with there. And I could have sworn I had walked down the aisle of Al's Toy Barn for the Sea of Cowboys, Woody's, in parentheses, I saw there. They wouldn't sell Woody's there because he's a vintage toy. I tell you, it was like last night's rave, 5 stars. It was like walking down the aisle of an Al's Toy Barn. A lot of buzz. This, 5 star review here for a double IPA from Tony here on Google Reviews. This double IPA got me very drunk. After even one sip, I could have sworn I was walking down the Lightyear aisle of Al's Toy Barn because I got a great, there was a lot of buzz. I got a good buzz off it. Fuck. But look, how you, I don't know. I have nothing more else to say about the NCT, but Sonny was delighted to see someone put the car on a lift because he likes the car. So any new way that he can see it from a different angle on a plinth, it's the same thing that like parents love seeing their kids on carousels because it's like putting your kid on like a little display case, Put them on a horse and spin them around. I want to see that kid from every angle, My kid. Not weird if I say that. It's like when, I follow a lot of, actually it's quite a relief now. My Instagram, you press the little search, search thing on your Instagram, and then it has like basically what the algorithm thinks you are. Up until recently, the algorithm thought that I was a TMNT, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle obsessed, lecherous pervert. Because it was all boobs and turtles action figures. Now it's mostly turtles action figures, which I'm happy to see. I think I get a better rush seeing, say, the Universal Monsters inspired turtle figures. Donatello's Frankenstein, Raphael's the Wolfman, Michelangelo's the Mummy, which is a bit boring. Never been that impressed by the Mummy, Do like Brendan Fraser's The Mummy, of course, as huge fan of that. So finally broken free of the boob algorithm. I think I'm growing up, which is great news. Great news for me. But look, how are you? I don't know what I'm going to talk about today. Well, I kind of do know what I'm going to talk about. What was I going to talk about? I've been reading a phenomenal book called Storyworthy by Matthew Dix. That's his name. And it's a great book about how you should reflect at the end of your day and see what was the most storyworthy moment. Matthew Dix is a moth storytelling Grand Slam champion. And he gives you various techniques to help you kind of craft stories. At the moment, I'm only in the part of the book that's kind of in the story finding side of things. Exercises that you can do to kind of brainstorm potential ideas for stories. I'm not yet at the period where I can actually tell a good... You might notice from listening to this podcast that I kind of run out of steam with all my stories. It's like when I used to write essays. When I was a kid, I'd write like creative writing essays or stories, and I'd be building momentum, and I had no idea where it was going to end. Never dreamt of starting with the end in mind. But it'd be building and building and building, and then it would just like fall off a cliff on the last page. Never knew how to finish the story. Still don't. In an anecdote, I'm able to at least kind of like not reveal the entire story in the first sentence. But I'm always like, yeah, it's weird, you know. All my stories end in kind of, it was just weird, you know. It was just weird seeing that. And I think I need to have, I think I need to look at the purpose of why that story resonated with me a bit better and see if that's changed me at all, whether it be perspective, whether it be physically, mentally, emotionally, if I am changed, if there is a different me on the other side of the story, albeit quite, you know, even small of a change. But there's some phenomenal exercises that he gives out that I might as well share with you because it's been a book that I've been reading, Storyworthy. So he has this technique, right? And I've been enjoying doing this each day because it's just a nice... I've never been good at, like, diary entries. And I've never been good at, like, you know, doing a deep dive analysis of my day or an appraisal or a daily review or a weekly review or any of that shit. And I'm not really good at that, you know? But for the sake of this podcast, I sometimes just go through my calendar and think, right, what happened there? What happened there? And this is kind of the purpose of this podcast, is I tell you what goes on in my life and I tell you what is the most story-worthy or at least interesting or at least funny or on-brand thing about me. And I'm looking to improve on that, and I'm looking to maybe take some of those stories and put them on the stage and get better at telling stories on stage and building suspense and maybe even, you know, adding a bit of heart to my stories rather than being like, and then Pat Kenny called me gay and he gave me an unlimited supply of booze, you know, which is a true story. But I've never been able to tell that in a way that is, I think, interesting or builds up momentum. So he's got some various techniques, so I'm going to go through some of them now. He has a thing called homework for life. Okay, boring. Okay. No, what he does is he basically says he has an Excel spreadsheet of the last, I think it's 15 years, and it's just daily. One kind of column is the date, and the other column is just the most story-worthy thing that happened that day. And at the end of each day, he just puts one thing in. I've been doing it for 1 week, less than 1 week. But I like what I have. So I have here, you know, like, I mentioned this on my Patreon podcast, Wednesday, October 4th, went to a chiropodist. He was an old guy, cash only. There was monastic monk chants playing on the radio, and he had me waiting 40 minutes. I told that story on the Patreon about how I was already scared of podiatrists and chiropodists. And when I rocked up at this guy's place, it was very cloak and dagger. And when I went in, that all these choral chants and monastic chants were playing on Lyric FM for some reason, and it really put me in a deep state of unease. Thursday, can't tell you that one. Friday, can't tell you that one. Thursday, I was chasing up a missing invoice, and then to my surprise and delight, and anger then, but then again delight, I chased up a missing invoice and found out that there was actually more invoices that I hadn't even sent. There was a handful of invoices for things that I hadn't sent, and I'm like, oh my God, free money, essentially. But also, had I not been chasing up the missing invoice, I could have lost money, you know. And how I told my dad that, and he said he wanted to paddle me. And I thought that was weird. He said he wanted to paddle me, you know. Friday, I met my agent, John, and chatted about plans for the tour for 2024. And I think I told him too much stuff, and he seemed overwhelmed and annoyed, which I found funny. Because I was like, he's my agent, you know, and I'm like, I want to do this, this, and this, and he's like, oh, you know, and I thought that was funny, you know. He's a great agent, and it'll all get done, but I just thought the initial reaction of him just being like, what, and what, you know. Saturday, October 7th, Sonny did football. He's in this little football thing in like a parish centre, runs around, kicks balls with a bunch of kids. He's very good at it. But Terry normally brings him, and then when he saw me, whenever he noticed me just standing there watching, and whenever he like just clocked eyes at me, he would like immediately stop whatever, you know, the coach was telling him to do and run over and like grab my leg and ask me to pick him up. And at first I was kind of like, oh, you know, I want it to be like, I mean, it's totally peer, it's totally pressure from other parents. I don't want to seem like I'm, the first thing that goes to my head is like, oh, you know, does it look like I've raised a child who's not as independent, you know, as the other kids? And then I was like, fuck that, like, you know. And I got over that pretty quick. And then I was also thinking, do you know what? There's going to be one day I'm going to have to fucking fight to pick him up or give him a hug. And right now he wants me to pick him up. So I will take that shit. So whenever I picked him up and gave him a hug, he would just ask to go down and run back over to the kids. You know, so it just made me a bit appreciative of the time that we have. And, you know, seeing the kind of years ahead of me when he won't want that. And then that night, me and Terry watched Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning and laughed our asses off. Because it's really the... Look, I know, you know, when Tom Cruise makes a Mission Impossible film with Christopher McQuarrie, they start with the set pieces. In this case, Cruise says, I want to jump off a mountain on a motorbike with a parachute. And Christopher McQuarrie said, well, I want to crash a train into a river. And they went, okay, we'll figure that out. And they were the only real main set pieces. There's an exciting enough chase through Rome, but I feel like I've seen that before. But then what they have to do is basically figure out a reason for you to get from A to B, you know? They come up with the set pieces and they write the dialogue in between. However, this time, I don't know if this was a thematic choice because the arch villain in this case is an AI, but the dialogue, and I know this is a hack criticism to say, but it seemed totally written by AI. Even the delivery. In the first 20 minutes, there's like a scene with like the NSA and the director of intelligence, or maybe it's the CIA, I don't know what they do. And they're all kind of like explaining what the situation is. Like Rob Delaney's in there. You're one from This Way Up, and she's one of the snakes from Game of Thrones. You know, she's a very good actor. They're like delivering this exposition, but they're all like cutting each other off to get to the next sentence. You know, we're talking about an AI, artificial intelligence, the likes of which we've never seen, sir. And, you know, if we can't do anything to stop this thing, could mean World War III. Luckily, the Russians have built it. Like, everyone is cutting over the same, like, cutting over, like, they were all saying the same thing. And they're not looking at each other. This would be a difficult thing to do, to literally finish someone's last sentence. And they're delivering it so emotionless. And it just seemed so absurd. And we were just laughing our asses off, me and Terry. So that was a nice evening. And like, you know, fun film. It's great to see Cruise do stuff. Hayley Atwell's great. She's cool girl. She's cool, you know. So that was enjoyable. Sunday, October 8th, we did a big job. Is in, we had to go through loads of clothes. Tell you what, the attic, I'm surprised it isn't warmer in the house, given the amount of fucking shite baby clothes we have stuffed in the attic. How, you know, who needs insulation when you can just have kids and a load of fucking odd socks everywhere, right? So it was just bags and bags. So I went up there. I was like, there's no point of storing clothes these kids are never going to wear again. So I'm like, we'll get rid of these. We'll give them, you know, to charity. And we'll give them to someone else. Anyone else has a kid. But they're leaving now. So either friends who maybe plan on having kids in a few years' time, they can take the clothes now or they're going to charity right now. So I was taking all the clothes down from the attic and I was putting them in Terry's lap. And she was freaked. She was, as soon as she would finish a bag, like two more big fucking black sacks would land on her lap. And she snapped at me and was really annoyed. And then we went for a cycle on our little Japanese bike, you know, the two seats on it. Went for a long cycle and then went to the pub. And because I didn't know how much time we were going to have with the kids sitting comfortably at the table, I necked fucking 3 pints in about an hour. And then I started singing Jesus to a Child loads to the kids, you know. And what have I learned from all this pain? Daddy, you're too close to my face. I thought I'd never feel the same about anyone or anything again. Daddy, stop it. But now I know when you find love. You know, so I was singing that loads. Normally you get a bit of Wheels on the Bus or, you know, Row, Row, Row Your Boat. But they were getting a full George Michael show, those kids, for bedtime. So that was fun. Then yesterday, I met a producer to talk about a potential pitch for something, and I didn't realize he was paying, and I put three different types of drinks down. It was in a Starbucks, and they were, like, you know, pretty expensive. One was, like, sparkling water. There was a big coffee in there, a deluxe-looking one, and also, like, an innocent kind of lemon and lime sparkling drink. I wasn't even hungover, but I wanted three drinks. But I thought I was paying, and then I didn't realize he was paying, and I felt really embarrassed, you know, because I thought I was getting all this shit for myself. And he's like, oh, I'll get that. And then I was like, ah, you know. So I don't know how... And then I also brought the car to the mechanic to fix the thing before my NCT. So look, that's just a week of stories. And I don't know how story-worthy they are. Maybe one or two might be little splices of color that I add when I'm telling a longer story, you know? Like me singing Jesus to a child, to the kids. Like how much of a better parent I think I am when I'm a bit steamed, you know? There could be one about me. I have a bit of a hyper focus when we're doing big jobs, and I will make the house a complete fucking kip before it is cleared out. So maybe the me bringing loads of clothes down and piling them on top of Terry might be a detail for that. The chiropodist might come up. I think that's a fun story about, and I'm probably gonna have to see him again, so that could be fun. Me buying a load of drinks, probably not, but it could, might come up, maybe not, probably not, but maybe two or three things there from a week. But when I have 365, you know, and I only do this podcast twice a week, so having at least a chronicle of the things will benefit this podcast and hopefully benefit the stand-up going forward. So that's the day-to-day tasks, story-worthy. It's also just a great thing, he says, just to kind of chronicle in your life. We have these calendars that we look back on, they look fairly empty. I don't know if you ever looked back on your calendar and actually tried to get a sense of the day, but for me, I find that very difficult, unless there's something out of the ordinary there. If you look back at the routine, it's hard for anything to jump out. And, I mean, these are all the things that I would talk about anyway going forward. You know what I mean? I probably wouldn't tell you that I successfully published a podcast or that I had a meeting and it is exciting for a future thing, you know? Maybe I could reference that meeting if this thing goes ahead, but in the meantime, I can just say that I had the producer pay for three drinks for me, you know, and I felt like a little drinks goblin. So, you know, so that's the day-to-day stuff. He also gave a great, now I'm not going to do it for you here, but I do a thing in the morning sometimes, especially when I need to clear my head, when I'm so preoccupied by something else that I don't know if I can start work or if I'm procrastinating work, I'll open a doc file and I'll just, for 10 minutes even, 10 or 15 minutes, just in a kind of stream of consciousness, write down everything. And what I normally get is if I get a paragraph of what's on my mind and getting that, you know, and what's annoying me and whatever, whenever that's cleared, then I kind of end up, it's almost like I'm kind of a sperm permeating the nucleus of an egg, you know. I get through the hard crust, that's all my grievances, then the soft gooey bit, which is my to-do list. And then deep in the core of that, as long as the sperm keeps fighting to get in there, is, you know, gestation. I don't know how kids work. But then in there is maybe the core of an idea or an original thought that I didn't realize was on the surface of my mind. On the outer surface is usually just my grievances. And then inside of that is the things I need to do. And then further in the core is things that I actually are inspired or the muse lies in the center of that core. So he has a great technique for this, which is called crash and burn, which is you basically are typing stream of consciousness and then you just can't stop. You can't stop typing. Can't stop typing at all for like 10 to 15 minutes. But then you have to just keep writing. So if you're like, okay, what's going on? What's going on in my life? All right, I see a little microphone in front of me. Microphone makes me think of how I did a gig one time at the Laughter Lounge and I bombed three nights on the trot. And after three nights of literally getting no laughs, it was the same MC every night. I thought to myself, I said to him, oh, I don't know what's going wrong. And I was saying the same jokes and they were really bad. And I said to him, I wonder what's going on. Maybe it's how I'm holding the mic. And he just went, he'd been so muted and quiet about me doing so bad for 3 days. And I was like, yeah, maybe it's how I'm holding the mic. And he goes, it's fucking nothing to do with how you're holding the mic. Just be funny. And I thought that was funny. Maybe it's how I'm holding the mic. It's nothing to do with how you're holding the mic. And then went in like a new thought. So then my friends, Connor and Omar, were there. And Omar was just in from London, where he was living. And so you kind of will move on from, and like you would do like a kind of a dash and then move on to the next thought. And like literally in the middle sometimes of what you're writing about. You know, because when you go back and then review it, you don't need to see the finished sentence because you'll remember where the inspiration that thought came from. Maybe there was more to this me bombing on stage and the MC saying I had nothing to do with my mic. I probably don't need to finish the whole thing. I moved on to now. Omar lived in London. He was over. I don't know if he'd seen me do stand-up before. Probably wasn't the best gig for him to see. He was very sweet about it. He's a very sweet guy. He was always the one of our mates who would be the most morally good person. And then I could go into like a story about him being, you know, Omar potentially being morally good. And then that might inspire me to tell another story from my childhood. And then you just keep going like that. But you don't stop and you just latch on to whatever the next thought is. And then he says, if you ever get stuck, you can do things like start listing colors, you know, red, blue, green, yellow, brown, yellow makes me think of Bruce Lee and Bruce Lee's yellow outfit and the Kill Bill inspired one, and how they had martial law from Tekken, and there was also your man who was meant to be kind of a Jackie Chan kind of knockoff, and the fact they had a Bruce Lee knockoff. Also, I didn't realize that King was wearing a mask. I didn't know what a luchador was. I thought he was an actual tiger. And then I could imagine what it would be like to actually have someone fight a tiger in a wrestling ring, you know, if you're thinking of it. So I could just keep going. And then it might not be good, but then you can go back and just think, what you're just trying to, you know, cast is a wide net for stories that might have a further depth. And I've done that before, and it's been very beneficial, and it's actually made me remember things. But then he gives another technique, which is also a fun game that you can play, and it is called first, last, best, worst. And first, last, best, worst is where you pick some random words and you try and remember your first thing of that. So it could be job. First job I had was working in Dunn Stores. An interesting story from that would be that they gave us all our outfits, and I was given like a medium, which was my size at the time, and there was a girl sitting behind me, and she was given like an extra large, and I was like, oh, and she seemed really disappointed, and I was like, oh, here, look, do you want to have this medium, you know, whatever, I can probably tuck the extra large in, you know, I still wore some extra large stuff occasionally, maybe some cool skate wear or whatever, and she goes, really, oh, thanks, and then she stood up, and she was 7 foot tall. She was set as a woman, was 7 foot tall. And then she put it on, fit great on her, whatever, a little bit tight to be fair. And then I put on my fucking dress. I put on a fucking dress. And I'm there walking around Dunn Stores with a hairnet and a hat on top and a dress. Like I'm playing fucking dress up, like I'm a child. Like I'm a child who fell out of a fucking wardrobe. You know, I looked stupid. And I was like that. I think that's part of the reason I quit. So that was my first job. My last job was my last actual job was when I went in to Havas Media, thinking that I was going in there to be a freelance copywriter, a freelance consultant, and they actually thought that I was trying to get a job as a copywriter, and I was just like following people around for 2 weeks, and then when I finished, I invoiced, being like, all right, there's my consultancy fee, and they're like, what? What are you talking about? We thought you were in here to like start a job as a copywriter, and then you left after 2 weeks. And I'm like, this is why we should have communicated better. And they did pay, to be fair, which was mad. I thought I was literally interned, and I thought I was like some big fucking swinging dick. Yeah, get in there, get a fucking comedian in there, jazz up those jokes. So that's technically my last job. My best job I ever had. is probably the one that I have now. The best kind of working environment I ever had within that job was probably we were making GUTF. We had a nice writer's room. When we were shooting, it was all very collaborative. It felt a lot of fun. The fact that we were all doing it independently, there was no studio notes or you know, network notes or anything like that. So that was a lot of fun. My worst job was I had selling homewares, like just like Delf and plasticky shit, door to door, wearing a suit. And I saw an ad online. For whatever reason, I just had it in my head, like, I don't want to work in a shop. I don't want to work in retail. I don't want to work in service. I want to work in an office now, you know, but at 18, it's very limited. So I took this online ad. It was online sales, and it was a like, big commission. Earn now. You know, here's your interview. Wear a suit. So I spent €100 on a suit, you know, and so I was already, we were already in the red. We were starting in the red. And then went through this induction with this kind of like hotshot fucking, you know, Gordon Gekko, Wolf of Wall Street wannabe guy. And then we were sent out, got the bus out to Tala, was wheeling around a massive suitcase full of plastic weighing scales or some shit, going door to door. And we opened one door in Tala and a guy shot me in the dick with a BB gun. And then on my way home, I was wearing a suit and I saw all my mates. It was one of the hottest days of the summer, and I saw all my mates driving to the beach, and they saw me in my suit, and they were honking a horn and laughing at me. And I was miserable with a sore dick. So that would be the worst job I ever had, and it only lasted one day. So that's an example of what that would look like. But I did pick a few more if you want to hear them. I mean, I hopefully this is as interesting for you. I did. That was one straight off the top of the dome, but I kind of worked one out today. ChatGPT gave me 5 one-word prompts. I might limit this just to 4 because I already did one there with job. And I can also then store all these. I can keep all these in an Excel spreadsheet, being like gig, roommate, vacation, performance. These are the suggestions they gave me. Because that's not going to change. They're the first, last, best, worst. And maybe I might look back on those and there might be more stories from it. First gig I ever went to was Foo Fighters. I worked it out. That was on the 5th of December 2000. So I would have just turned 13. And my cousin Tony brought us. And I just remember him leaving us for ages. He just kept going buying pints. He just had so many pints. Every time he would sit down, he'd neck a pint. He'd go back up and get another pint. I remember buying a bootleg Foo Fighters t-shirt outside that I found out as soon as I got home was basically just a big sticker that someone had stuck on a t-shirt. I still wore it with pride for years. That was a great gig. That was 2000. That was before, you know, All My Life and, you know, what album was that even? So that was just after, like, Colour in the Shape, really. And it was a great gig, and I couldn't believe it. I thought it was the most amazing thing I'd ever seen. I'd never been to a gig before, and I think that's when you kind of see a live band, you kind of, you know, rock music is kind of this abstract kind of thing, and then you see it and you feel it, and you go to a gig like that, and then I was a rocker. I was a fucking rocker from the 5th of December 2000. So that was a great, great first gig. The last gig I went to go see was Soft Cell and Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark in St. Anne's Park. That was a really fun gig. It was nice to see, to be at a gig in your mid-30s. We just kept buying cocktails, and I kept trying to get people to sit on my shoulders, you know. So that was a lot of fun. Best gig I ever went to was, I was a diehard Him fan. You know, you find out about Him from watching Bam Margera videos, then you listen to Him, and then you get it. You know, it's metal, but it's soft as shit. It's like Neil Diamond, you know, infused hard rock. And it was amazing. It was, that was 2004, June 4th, 2004. So I was 16. And it was an amazing gig. They would play the Ambassador then 2 years later, and Bam Margera was there. But he was a fucking prick. He dove off the balcony like 20 feet in the air, landed on people. What a piece of shit. But then there was footage of that in an episode of Viva La Bam at that gig. Wasn't as good of a gig. The first gig was absolutely amazing, where I just knew every single word. I was just screaming from my toes, every single. And my favorite hymn song is Death's in Love with Us. And, you know, it's a fucking, it's an album track. And I don't think they normally play it live. And when they said they were going to play it, I think that's one of the happiest moments I've ever had at a gig, you know. So that was a lot of fun. Was that gig. That was the best gig I ever went to. The worst gig I ever went to was seeing Kanye West at Glastonbury. It was shite. It was shite. It was raining. He sounded shite. Bon Iver came out and he was singing with him. He sounded shite, even though I like Bon Iver. And I also was, I mean, I don't know if we were in the right buzz for it. We were sitting up in like the kind of, there's a part of Glastonbury where it's kind of you can overlook the whole campsite, and there's all these kind of like monolithic kind of stone monuments, and we went up there, and this guy with one big Padawan dread came along and offered us an edible chocolate, and I was like how much should we take? And he said, well, these are, I work as a kind of a terminal, as a hospice nurse, and I give these to my patients, so I would recommend half. And I was like, yeah, but I smoke weed sometimes. At the whole thing, huge, huge mistake. Let this be a word of warning to you, right? Anyone ever says this is an edible for terminally ill patients, eat half. Me and Terry were speaking telepathically for 5 hours, speaking exclusively with our blinks, you know. And she was trying to get us ready for Kanye, and I was just in the tent, you know, by torchlight, combing my hair with my eyes closed for ages, and my mate Connor was sorting his socks and just kind of furling them and unfurling them into little sock piles, and Terry was laughing her ass off. She was crying laughing. She couldn't believe that we were just in there together, like doing these kind of like locked in, hyper-focused jobs. And then we went to the gig and was shite. He was shy. So I was off, out on Kanye from then. Although one of the best gigs was, I went to go see Kanye and Jay-Z at Hackney Weekend. Well, it was actually just Jay-Z, and then Kanye came out and they did N-Word Snowden. They did N-Word Snowden's in Paris, and was singing along to that at the bits I could. Not the N-Word Snowden parts. All right, so that was first, last, best, worst. Might have something there for the first gig with the Foo Fighters. That's a first ever gig. There might be more to that about me becoming a rocker. The worst gig at Kanye, the edible, was certainly a noteworthy thing. Might fit in with a larger story about bad edible experiences. And maybe me being a kind of a love metaler might fit in with him at the ambassador potentially. All right, first, last, best, worst roommates, right? My first roommate was my ex-girlfriend and two of my pals. We got us gaff in Homerton, in London. We just moved over to London, and we thought it was like a fucking mansion. But then my ma came over to stay, and she didn't say at the time, but afterwards she said it was probably the dirtiest gaff she's ever seen in real life. We thought it was incredible. It had a pond in the back garden with a fish in it, like a big fucking goldfish. And we never fed this goldfish, and it just stayed alive. We were there for like 2 years. And this fish never died, you know. And I once put my dick in the pond for a dare. There was someone dared me to lie over the pond with my dick and did my dick in it, and I did. So there's that. My last roommate was my wife and kids as well. I suppose my last roommate's my daughter. And she's a top buzzer. She's actually pretty sound. One of the better roommates I've had. She's always up for the crack, you know. My best roommate's probably my wife, but nostalgia would have me believe that it was my pals Jordan and Alan and Dan when we lived in this rat flat in Clapton in London. But they would also be, with great respect to them, my best friends, but also the worst roommates. You know, we refused to pay for the heating sometimes, And so I would come home from work, and it was on, the heater and the electricity were on this card that you had to top up. And I would just come home sometimes after work, like 9 o'clock, and they would just be sitting there in the sitting room by candlelight with duvets around them, because they're like, we're not paying today. I'm like, okay. We're not paying for electricity or, you know, but then we just order a takeaway. Do you know what I mean? So it's mad. It's insane, you know? We had the money for the takeaway, but we didn't have the money to pay for the electricity or the heating, you know? Terry went to visit me after we'd only met once, and she came over to stay. I said, you should come over and install, and I'll show you around London. And we'd only really met once before. And, you know, I was aware that the gap was a shithole, you know? And so I thought, right, what I need to do here is buy some new shower curtains. So I bought two new shower curtains, put one in the upstairs jacks, one in the downstairs jacks, even though the rest of the bathroom was covered in black mold and three rats that we later on, a few months later, found, you know. And I often think back at this. She brings it up, you know, about a shower, you know, the shower curtain. She brings it up all the time because I was so proud of the shower curtain, you know. So it's, you know, it's a memory and a moment that we look back on kind of fondly. But I also think, here, this is the fucking lad you married. You know what I mean? Like, you know, she should really lower her standards about what she expects of me now, you know. Like, you know, I often think this, that, you know, she's we have this kind of this unit as a family that we both run together. You know, we're co-CEO of this familial company, right? But she essentially, she met me when I was working in the fucking in the mailroom, you know, and it's been on her to be like, oh, I think we should promote this guy up to manager, and then promote this guy to CEO to be overlooking the whole thing. I think we should actually get this mailroom guy to overlook our finances. You know, I wouldn't go that direction, but she seems fairly confident on it. So I often think back at that this is the guy who thought two shower curtains could clean a whole house, essentially, you know. So there's probably a story in there about the rat gaff, my dick in the pond, and how amazing we thought this shithole in Homerton in London was, you know, and how are we not all... I mean, is you can put a new lick of paint on stuff, you know what I mean? But it's just really what the... it doesn't necessarily equate to more fun, better times, better quality of life, you know? It's a much nicer house that I live in now, but back in that first house, because just of the independence of it all, you know, being 22, it just felt like this was a mansion, and the extra bit of spice was just that pure independence. We keep going with these. I'll do two more things. I'll do vacation and performance. All right, vacation. The first one was Portugal. I think that's the last vacation we went on before my parents separated. My dad, who did sunbeds, used to be obsessed with doing the sunbeds. He just lay out in the Portugal sun, got fucking burned to a crisp beyond belief. I've still never seen a shade of red so pure. He looked like the Imperial Guards protecting the Emperor. It was so red, crimson. And the there's photos of him, and just the whites of his eyes against the contrast of the red. I've never seen anything like it. But also, my mom tells a story about how I couldn't pronounce my oars. So, and I had this like inflatable, like duck, kind of water rubber ring thing that I would be around my waist. And I kept saying, come on, wubber ducky, look in the water, wubber ducky. And she's obsessed with that. She always says wubber ducky to me. My memory of it, my only memory of it is that we got a Pez dispenser. I got a Pez dispenser there. And I was like, what the fuck is this? Oh my God, it's a toy that hands me sweets. What the fuck? And I was obsessed with it. And then I lost it somewhere and I was devastated. And I said, ma'am, can we please go to the shop to get, another one? And she goes, yeah, no, we'll go to the shop. And she would put on the long finger. And then eventually on the way to the airport, we pull into some shop. And she's like, this is the shop. Oh, they don't have it anymore. And I'm like, this doesn't look at all like the shop. And in retrospect now, I think it was a completely different shop. And it actually then makes me think about how we went to France, me and Terry and Sonny. We stayed in this Airbnb and they had a pool there. And we got this like in foam, like, you know, water pistol thing. You know, you kind of load up and squirt. You know, it's like a single kind of pump thing. And we couldn't be fucking arsed. It was really long. We couldn't be arsed. Like, checking it wouldn't fit in our bag, so we left it there. And Sonny still says, he's like, we're going to go back to France. We're going to get the water pistol. My green water pistol's in France. He might just say that out of nowhere to someone. Being like, oh, hi, Sonny. How you doing? My green water pistol's in France. We're going there. And how obsessed I was with that Pez dispenser, it makes sense. I think a story from that is that I can't be, because something is, I don't give a shit about something does not mean my son does not give a shit about something. Do you know what I mean? And to remember what it is to give a shit about something really small and minute, could be a story there. Last holiday was Tenerife. I don't know, but the most story-worthy thing for me, most on-brand thing for me, was I left my family to get cold drinks while they were on the beach, and I stopped into a shop on the strip and bought a vape, and it blew the fucking head off me, and I almost pulled a whitey. Came back with like some cold Sprites and stuff, and cold apple juice for Sonny, and I look white as a sheet, and Tara's like, you all right? I'm like, yeah. This fucking vape blew the head off me. Best holiday I ever went on was Japan. Went for 3 weeks. I could talk about it for days. You know, the people, the food, the service, and it's probably actually the only holiday that I didn't want to spend. Every holiday on the third day, I just want everyone to leave me alone, and I want to stay in the room and look at my phone. This is the only holiday that I've wanted to get up and get out and not be left alone. So that's something. Worst holiday was, went to Malmo and Copenhagen with my ex while we were still together, even though we'd broken up. And I was just, you know, it's one of those things, one of those kind of, it was kind of like the opposite of before sunrise. It was the anti before sunrise. Just these long conversations, walking across the stunning Copenhagen city streets, while kind of just slowly breaking up. Kind of beautiful, actually. You know, a lot of self-reflection, and might make a good screenplay someday. First, last, best, worst performance. My first ever performance was, there was a talent show called Cadenza in Art School Riche, that Miss Kelly, the music teacher, would put on. And me and Lorcan Clancy begged our music teacher, Miss Kelly, if we could host the talent show. And she said, okay, eventually. And so we made like this intro sketch that we did, that we shot in my cousin Omar's house, where we were like, I wake Lorcan up and I'm like, Lorcan, wake up. We're presenting Cadenza in 15 minutes. And then he jumps out of bed and we just run from Artane all the way to Marino, to Art School Riche. And it was just scenes of us running to the Beatles' Can't Buy Me Love. And then this is the shot we were so proud of. We were in like the school hall and we recorded ourselves about to like open the doors of the school hall. And we timed it perfectly with a specific sound cue so that when that video played before the talent show, we literally opened the doors at the exact same time that you saw it on the screen. And we thought this was fucking cutting edge videography. We thought cinematography, even. I'll even go one more. We thought these fuckers out there, these cunts, is going to blow their heads off. They're going to be like, what? So this whole video was a live stream, you know? And people loved it, and we were so proud. My last gig that I did was the Dublin Fringe. I had a wonderful time. I really enjoyed doing some different things for it. I mean, around that time, actually, think about it, at Cadenza, if I had known that I would be ever doing the Dublin Fringe, I would have been very excited and very proud. So I was a huge fan. But I always thought that was something beyond me to do, like, the Dublin Fringe. So delighted that that's... I don't know if there's a story in that, but, you know... if you had told me presenting Cadenza that I was going to do a show, even a single night in the Dublin Fringe, I would have been like, what? What? And got really excited. My best gig I ever did was, I don't know if you were ever there, but the first gig I ever did in the Sugar Club. Jesse Heffernan, who was booking nights there, asked me if I wanted to do an hour. And I was like, okay, didn't have an hour. So wrote an hour in like 2 months, maybe less, a month. And even though the jokes weren't necessarily great, and there was even one sketch that I did with, was Peter on that one? No, I don't think Peter was on that show. I had Peter McGann join me for a show where I was just basically in love with him, reading bingo numbers, and I gave him a kiss at the end. And he was a good sport, let me do it, but it wasn't a funny sketch at all. It was actually kind of a more, very kind of a tragic queer play. I realized in retrospect, you know, I thought it was really funny. And not funny as in, like, you know, gay things are funny, but I thought it was kind of a funny thing where I was reading bingo numbers and every number was making me think of how in love I was with another guy who worked in this nursing home. I was a nursing home guy reading bingo, and Peter was another guy that worked there, and every number reminded me of, you know, of him in different facets. Went on for too long, and then eventually I kissed him and people cheered, but yeah, it was kind of more of a more of a queer play than it was a sketch. But beforehand I did but anyway, it was the first gig I did after the Plune video, and Maz Mates had been a success. So I did Plune, I did Maz Mate, I did Dublin Frenchman at it. It was a solo show, totally oversold. There was like people just like huddled in on the steps. I'll never really oversell something that big, but can't deny how big and, you know, loud and just fucking... I landed, the first joke landed, and I just couldn't believe that this was my life. And I was like, I'm destined to make sure this is my life for the rest of my life. And then the worst gig actually was the Laughter Lounge. Those 3 nights on the trot when I died. And then, yeah, the most notable thing was that after 3 days of dying, and it was the same MC, and he eventually just turned to like not like me very much at the end, because he was just like, you're fucking wrecking my night. And he also said something to me on the first night. We were talking about stand-up, and he was like, and I was like, I might try some new stuff. And he's like, don't try any new stuff. And I was like, oh, okay. And he goes, no, don't try any new stuff. This is a place to like showcase stuff. Don't be trying any new stuff. So then I didn't. So then when I didn't do well on the first night, I was like, well, I'm not going to try any new stuff. Your man just gave out to me for even suggesting that. So I went out doing the same shit over and over and over again. Did not adopt, adapt, and improve. And then eventually I was like, yeah, maybe it's how I'm holding the mic. And he's like, it's not how you're holding the fucking mic. Just be funny. And then the owner of the Laughter Lounge came out and he was like, look, Tony, normally people tell their funniest jokes first. And I was like, okay. You know, not for me. I think I'd probably be all right at it now. I think I'd get it a bit more now. But I was just going out there being weird, talking about MSN Messenger and wanking, you know? Like, I'm literally, you know, these people in front of a fucking stag do. You know, they don't want to hear that shit. So, yeah, those are my first, last, best, worst. My worst gig at Laughter Lounge certainly be a story about learning how to get better at comedy. You know, I mean, that wouldn't have been too far off the Sugar Club show, you know, and to have such a good show and then such a bad show. It can be very jarring and unexplainable. You know, it's hard to kind of figure out exactly why some things work and some things don't. And then my first gig that we did was like the first kind of video that I made is like a video sketch. And that's still a part of my shows that I do now. And that was like the first thing that I did. So look, I don't know if you're interested in any of this shit, but I'm certainly going to be trying this first, last, best, worst technique. If I I'm ever working things out to help me write some stand-up, might even find some one-liners in there. But I think as I do more gigs and as I continue doing comedy, I don't tell a lot of stories in this podcast. I don't tell a lot of stories on stage, so I'd like to do more of that. So that's your homework. Your homework for life is every single day write down the most story-worthy moment. And even if you're not looking to become a comedian or a storyteller or a writer or anything like that, certainly it makes good dinner conversation. Also, this first, last, best, worst thing is just a really fun game for like a long drive in the car. So there you are. Hopefully you enjoyed that. I've enjoyed talking to you about it. And when I read more about this book, when I read more about how to actually craft a story, you're the fucking first person I'm going to tell. Don't you worry about that. But anyway, look, if you want to come see me live and some pals live, GUTF, Get Up to Fuck, the morning show, is coming to the Pooka Festival in Trim on the 28th of October. It'll be me and Shane Daniel Byrne, Martin Angolo, Michael Fry, Killian Sunderman, Peter McGann, Emma Dorn, and I think Justine Stafford as well will be there one of the nights. And Peter McGann will be there one of the nights. Won't tell you which. I know I will. Full cast list to be revealed over the next few weeks. But there's also then going to be another night on the 18th of November. And that is in the Civic in Tallaght. So that's going to be a lot of fun. So do come see us. Also on the 30th of November, me and Alison Spittle are doing our own Late Late Toy Show. The day before the toy show. So the toy show is going to be on the 1st of December. So ours is Thursday, the 30th of November. So that's going to be in London, in the London Irish Centre over there. So that'll be a London gig for any London folk who want to come see it. On the 6th of December, I'll be doing a Christmas special in the Workman's. Tickets, hopefully, on sale for that. hopefully the end of this week. And I'm hoping to do another November gig in the Workman's as well. I'm just figuring out an exact date. But that is Wednesday, the 6th of December, in the Workman's. And I'll hopefully have a few other gigs popping up now and then. Thank you very much for listening to this pod. I like you. I'm fond of you. All the best. Bye-bye. Kindness in your eyes, I guess. You heard me cry. You smiled at me like Jesus to a child. I'm blessed. I know heaven sent. Heaven stole. Always by my side.